am right now. Wasn't holding you up, so there's nothing I can do to let you down. It doesn't take a trophy to make you proud. I'll never be more loved than I am right now. Ooh.
Going through a storm, but I won't go down. I hear your voice carried in the rhythm of the wind to call me out. You would cross an ocean, so I wouldn't drown. You've never been.
Thank you. Just so we can say hello, send a note to you, welcome you, see how we can pray for you this week. So we'd appreciate you doing that. We are having men's breakfast on July 20th. Woo-hoo. I do not know what they're having to eat. That's always a question, so you just have to come to find out. I don't really know. Breakfast. Yeah, food. Yeah. And then Hooves of Hope. How many have been to Hooves of Hope? It will be on July 21st again, so mark your calendars for that. We're going to go into prayer time and then continue our worship. During our next song, we're going to be passing our offering baskets. That's for our regular tenders to put their tithes and offerings in. So if you're a guest, please don't feel that you need to do that. Would you stand with me? I'd also like to take a minute to pray for our kids. They're coming home from kids camp today, traveling. Mercies for them to get back home. They should be here around 4:35 is what I was told. So don't be late to pick up your kids. All right, Heavenly Father, I thank you for today. I thank you for sunshine. I thank you that even in times of uncertainty, Lord, and transition, and even for me, Lord, our feelings take over. We just have to stop and praise you. We stop and pray and pray and praise you, Lord. Our perception changes. And you get the glory, and I just was able to resurface my mind and my thoughts and to think, it's all about you, Lord. It's not about me or what I want or how I feel. It's you have the path, Lord. You have a plan and the glory for our lives, and I thank you for that. I thank you for the ability to have the freedom to pray, Lord. I pray that you'd be with the kids and the counselors traveling back today, that you would keep them safe. I pray that they have beautiful stories to share, Lord, of how you spoke to them and poured into their lives. And that seed has been planted, Lord, and they carry that out through their life, Lord. Thank you for those that are here today and those that are watching today. Please be with those that can't, God. I give you praise today, Lord, that you have new mercies for us every day. I'm so thankful for that. Thank you for our freedom to be able to come to worship, Lord. Be with our country. Be with this service, Lord. Be with this time that we worship and obey whatever you call us to do. In your name I pray, amen.
Through repentance at the cross.
So whatever I'm feeling, I've still got a reason to You've Been So Good, and I asked this person if I could share, and he said that'd be great. So I just want to give praise to God because our good friend Dave Smith is here today in the house. Woo! It's his first time back. For those of you who don't know, Dave's been in the hospital for March 5th. And he's had some great encounters, close calls with God. And God has a purpose for him. And I'm so thankful that he's here and that God's going to keep healing him. And I just believe he's going to use his testimony to help others. So thank you. Thank you, God, for allowing him to be here. If you need some inspiration or don't understand what's going on in your life, this is one person who can obviously tell you he's had an encounter with God.
So
kids, you are dismissed. This morning, I have the privilege of introducing our speaker for today, and it is Pastor Bob Anderson and his wife, Marilyn. They're from St. Ann, Illinois now. They've lived there 3 years. He retired 3 years ago after 48 years of pastoring that God has called him to. And they have two beautiful grown children, two girls. So would you please give a warm welcome to Pastor Bob.
Thank you. Good morning. I'm glad to be here with you. You're stuck with me for the next couple of weeks. I just want you to know I'm just an ordinary guy, and my heart is open to you. As we go through these times together, we're like two ships passing in the night, but we'll make sure the passing is a good thing. I just want you to know I've been praying for you. I will continue to pray for you. And we'll just have some fun in the next couple of weeks. That's not okay? You ready to do that? All right, I want to turn to Acts chapter 2. And we're going to read verses 1 through 6. Stand with me, if you will, please. This is one of the pyramid moments of the church, the beginning days. Acts chapter 6, 2, 1 through 6. When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Suddenly, the sound like a blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. Now, there were staying in Jerusalem God-fearing Jews from every nation under heaven. When they heard this sound, a crowd came together in bewilderment because each one of them heard him speaking in his own language. Father, this is all about you. This is your time. This is your place. This is your church. We await your anointing, the power and presence of your Holy Spirit to accomplish in these next few moments exactly what you want to draw from your word today into the hearts of your people. So we lay ourselves at the foot of the cross. And Lord, as we proceed into these moments, just help each of us here to get it right, but to leave this place with a sense that we've been in the presence of God. In your name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. I want you to know something, and if you forget anything else I say, I want you to remember this. God longs to bless you. God longs to bless this church. God longs to bless his family, to reach out and make a connection with us from the law to from the garden to the beginning of the law of Moses. God was making preparation to bless us. Through the angelic visits to Joseph and Mary, God was making preparations to bless us. Through the 3 years of his earthly ministry, Jesus himself was making preparations to bless us. Luke 22, Jesus says this. He guides his disciples to the very place where the blessing would be received. He says this, "Go and make preparations for us to eat the Passover. As you enter the city, a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him to the house he enters." I don't know if you understand this or not, but there are probably 250,000 people in Jerusalem on that day. And someone could have said, "Lord, how are we supposed to find this place?" And Jesus said, "Well, just follow the guy with the jar of water on his head." Among 250,000 people, guess who carried all the water in those days? The women. To see a guy with a jar on his head was very rare. Only God could plan that. Only God. I have a phrase I live by, that God always plans ahead, and his timing is always perfect. So in God's perfect timing, he put a guy who for some reason didn't have somebody else to carry the jar, and he put it on his head. And off to the place, so they followed him to the very place where the blessing of God would begin to be found. It was in the upper room. In that place became the birthplace of the church. In the moments before his ascension, as all the ministry of Jesus had done and all the heartache of the crucifixion and the tomb and the resurrection and the 10 days of loving and ministering upon his people, and then he's leaving to go to this place. He said this: "Do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift of my Father, the Father promised, which you've heard me speak about." Acts 1:8, one of my favorite verses: "But you will receive power when the Spirit comes upon you. You will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in Judea, in the uttermost part of the earth." God was saying, "I'm getting ready to bless you. I'm getting ready to do something that will just expand your territory. I've heard of the ministries that you have just extending out over this community, and I'm so proud of you, glad that your ministry goes far beyond the walls of this church." And that's a beautiful thing as you look outward. When I think about all the preparation that God did to bring this about, now it was in the hands of a group of people. One of the angels said to Jesus when he came back to heaven, "Jesus, what if these people that you left down there don't blow it? Given their history, not a very good track record." But Jesus said, "No, that's the plan." And here we are, 2,100 years later, and the Church of Jesus Christ is alive, and God is still moving, and God is still working, and the kingdom of God is still real, and the blessings are still being poured out. We have a God who loves this church. Those disciples, gone through heartache, gone through the death of their beloved Savior, understood, tried to figure out the resurrection, a few days of appearing here and there and disappearing in their midst, and then he stands on a mountain, says a few words, and elevator to heaven. I would love to see that. How did that happen? You know, did he just go, "Hey, guys"? I don't know. Did he look really heavenly? Did he have some pose? You know, it's like, "Okay, Lord, send the spaceship down and pick me up. Beam me up, Scotty." I don't know how he did it, but he went back to heaven, and all of a sudden that earthly Jesus, the one who was so present, the one who was so close, the one who was so available, you could eat lunch with him and have supper with him and hug him and shake his hand and see his smile and hear his voice, and that was gone. Jesus was just gone. And now what do we do? Jesus said that there would be a blessing. Jesus said that something's coming. And I need you guys to make a choice. Will you wait on the blessing? Will you go your own way? In those next 10 days, 120 people, give or take a few, basically gathered every day in one large room, the birthplace of the church, the upper room that Jesus had prepared in advance for them to find. And in that place, they waited and they prayed. I think there were some that said on day two or day three, "You know what? Where's the blessing? I'm out of here." There might have even been some that made it to 8 or 9 that said, "I don't know, man. Time's flying here. Where's this blessing? Maybe they left on day 9 in the afternoon." I can't imagine how they must have felt the next day when they realized what took place. "Oh, man, I missed it." But those that obeyed, those that stayed, those that sought through were there when centuries, when millennia of preparation by God was fulfilled. And the blessing of the Holy Spirit came into that room, and they were never the same again. Everything changed in their life. Their outlook, their perspective, their hope, their faith, their belief. You think they believed in Jesus before? When the Holy Spirit showed up and gave them power, oh, man, did something happen, and it happened in an incredible way. And from that day on, to this day, God is pouring out his Spirit. I want to tell you this, a short story about a man that really got this right. His name was Bud. He was literally born in a log cabin in the hills of Tennessee. At 12 years of age, his dad, just a scrub farmer, very profound poverty, 13 kids in his family, living in a log cabin in the hills of Tennessee. His dad died when he was 12. Mom, no education, no ability, picked the family up, and for some reason, moved to Texas. Because there was no money, all the kids had to work. None of them ever went to school. Bud decided that he was going to make some of the wrong choices, and he became a cowboy. And he ran with that cowboy crowd, and he was in the bars, and he was doing all the things that those guys did on the rowdy Saturday nights, and his life just descended into this quagmire of sin. And in fact, he got so good at being bad that they named him the tough guy. He had a reputation. But he also had a friend. And that friend found out that an evangelist was coming to town, and he pitched up a tent, and he started preaching about Jesus Christ. And he said, Bud, you got to come with me. No way on earth am I going. No, but for several weeks, resist. And then for whatever reason, except the God that plans ahead, Bud went to that tent. And on that night, he went to the altar, he bowed his head, he humbled his heart, and he accepted Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior of his life. Something happened in him that was so incredible, he couldn't express it. He was so filled with energy and so overjoyed that God could forgive his sin, the grievous as they were, that he went and he found a buck wagon, and he laid down underneath it, and he tried to sleep. He couldn't sleep. He was crying or praying or looking at the stars. He couldn't sleep. In the middle of the night, he got up. What he had in his possession was a gun in one pocket and a deck of cards in the other. He'd used both of them improperly. He said, I got to get rid of this stuff. And he went up, and he got rid of the gun, and he burned the cards. And he went back and he laid down and he said, my heart was so filled with praise. And he was just open to God. God, whatever you want from me, whatever you need, whatever you require, I'm here, I'm available to you. And that night, God called Bud to be a preacher of the gospel. There were three problems that made this really, really weird for him. Bud couldn't read. Bud couldn't write. And Bud had a stutter that made having a conversation with him almost impossible. Anybody who knew Bud would have said, God, you've got to be kidding. Bud went to a Sunday school teacher who taught him how to read from God's word. At 20, he went to an elementary school and began to get an education. As he began to preach on his own, just starting out from nowhere, something incredible happened. Every time Bud stepped into the pulpit, the stutter stopped. He preached fluently. I actually have in my possession at home a cassette tape. How many of your oldest remember cassette tape? Okay, a few of you, all right? It's this little thing with wheels and a tape that goes right around and it makes noise, okay? You don't plug it into the computer. You actually have to push a button to listen to it. But I actually have a recording of him telling a life story of his. He just flowed. The words flowed out of him. Over the course of his 50-plus year ministry, Bud preached 32,176 sermons, led over 200,000 people to Jesus Christ. By the way, somewhere along the line, he came up with a nickname, or somebody gave him a nickname, and his nickname was Uncle Buddy Robinson. And he was one of the greatest evangelists in the history of the church. A drunken, broken, messed up, hard-hearted cowboy met Jesus at an altar. 200,000 people came into the kingdom. You think God works for us You think God plans to prepare a way for us? You think God longs to bless us? I want you to hear that today. I want you to own that today. I want you to receive that today. God longs to bless you. It's not like, oh, yeah, we ought to get around a blessing. It's like God is on his throne, leaning over and looking at you and reaching out to you and say, let me bless you. Let me bless you. Let me bless you. Just like those disciples of old, if we want the blessings of the Lord, we've got to make a decision. One of the great phrases that Uncle Buddy coined was this: get under the spout where the glory comes out. Now, some of you are too young to know what a spout is. A spout is like a faucet or a shower head or the nozzle on the end of a garden hose. If water comes through it, it sprays, okay? And that's what Uncle Buddy was talking about, that if we want the blessing of God, if we want his anointing, if we want his refreshing in our lives, if we want him to work into our lives, we have a responsibility, and that responsibility is to get under the spout, to make a choice. Those 120 disciples made a choice to go to that room. No one forced them to do it. They chose. They chose to go. They chose to obey the Lord. They chose to stay. And because they made that choice, they were in position to receive the blessing that God gave to them. And that is what becomes so important to us today, that if we really want the blessings of the Lord in our lives, we need to position ourselves under the spout where God can bless us. Remember, God longs to bless us. I really want you to hear that today. He's done all the preparation. Now, our part is to follow his leadership and to say, God, how do you want to lead us? And how does this blessing play out? Knowing where we are as a church, knowing where we are as individuals is extremely important, because God wants to bless us. He wants to bring it into our lives. And it's a crucial time right now in your life, in our society. The events that happened in Pennsylvania yesterday, the craziness of this world that we're living in, God wants to bless us. And folks, if we ever needed a blessing, do we need it now? Oh, do we need God's anointing on our church, in our lives, in the challenges of our lives? And God is in a position to do that. Like those disciples, God was working. If we ever needed leadership, we need it now. So I want to ask a couple questions. First is this: are we making wise choices? That's something really you should ask yourself every day. If you just get a little bit off course over the long haul, you're going to miss your goal by a mile. Today, in this circumstance, in this situation, wherever I am as a person, am I making a wise choice? Second, I think, is equally important: are we regularly coming to the throne of God and asking him to guide us? What does it say in James? You don't have because you don't ask. Remember, God longs to bless us. Jesus said if we'll come to the Father in his name, he'll give us anything we want, anything we need. And yet, I've heard people say, well, I'm in this crisis, and now all we can do is pray. Guess what? That's the first thing you should have been doing. Go to God, get before the throne, and when that happens, it just increases God's ability in your life. When you come before the throne, God's there. He's ready. He's waiting, and he longs to bless you. He says, get in position. And how do you do that? I've got a chair in my living room. That's my chair. That's my holy chair. That's where I meet Jesus every morning. And God knows I'm going to be there. And morning after morning after morning, God shows up. And those times are precious to me. The third question: are we as a church willing to listen to the leadership of the Holy Spirit as he prepares to bless us? I don't know what your future holds. You don't know what your future holds. We may make plans, and plans are good, but none of us can guarantee what tomorrow will bring. But we know someone who does. And we have a God in heaven who desperately wants to share that information to you through his word, through the voice of Spirit-filled people, through the speaking of the Spirit to your inner being, God will make his will known to you. He's really good at it. If you lean your ear in and say, Lord, I want to hear, God will speak. But he can't speak if you don't listen. He can't speak if your heart is closed. He can't speak if you're carrying resentment in your heart. And by the way, you know, the only person that is wounded by resentment is the person who carries it. Normally, the person you resent doesn't know that they're resented. They're going on with life. So am I in a place, in my daily walk with God, where I have positioned myself? We know that God has a plan for this church. He's blessed in the past. He will bless in the future. But only if each of us as individuals get in a place where where God can bless us. I have to make a choice. Am I in a position God can bless? How can we be certain of that position? This is what I want you to read here today. We must seek the abiding presence of the Holy Spirit of God. We must seek him. God doesn't show up and say, okay, I've got this hammer and I'm going to start pounding on you until you let me in. Yes, his Spirit calls out to us, but God has never forced the door. He will not force his way into your life. He'll stand in front of you with floodgates ready to open. But until you say, I need you. Until you say, Father, come into my life. Until you open your heart and seek him and say, God, just put me where you need me to be. Put me in the position I'm supposed to be in so you can flow through me the way you want to flow through me. When that happens, God shows up and moves. And it happens as an individual, and it happens as a church. Now, let's go back to our scripture and see what we can learn from it. Jesus literally led his disciples to the upper room where he gave them the sacrament of the Lord's Supper. How many blessings have come from that? Many scholars agree that the 120 disciples that the disciples that met in that room were the same 120 in the same room 3.5 years later. After 10 days of waiting and praying, the shutters blew open. Pardon me. The sound of a rushing mighty wind came in, and God began to pour his sanctifying presence into that room. The word that they use for wind is breath in Greek, it's called pneuma, and it literally means breath of God. God was just breathing into that room new life. God was breathing into that room new hope. God was breathing into that room an empowerment and a sense of positivity that we can do this. Remember where they were? Remember the situation in that upper room? The doors were locked. The windows were barred. They weren't worshiping. They were hiding. They were literally scared for their lives. Look what they did to Jesus. If we speak up, they're going to do the same thing to us. And they're there. Okay, what's the secret code to get in the door? That's where they were. If you really want to look at it, they had self-imprisoned. They were locked behind those doors, and their momentum was dead. And so God said, because you have obeyed me, because you've gathered together, and because you are here in one accord in this place, I'm not going to let a shutter on the window stop. And those windows burst open. The sunlight flooded in. And the presence of God, the Spirit of God, that I call them spiritual goose pimples. I'm getting them right now. Where you just know God's moving. Where you just know God's working. Where you just know God's in the process of doing something incredible. And all of a sudden, they felt that. Understand, this had never happened before in all of history. For the first time in all of God's timing, the Holy Spirit was now fully available to any person who would seek him. Heart blocked, anybody, anywhere, any stage of life can ask for God to come in. God knew his people couldn't carry out the mission of the church without the Spirit, so God did the equipping, and he made the process very simple. It wasn't a bunch of hoops to jump through. I kept thinking about this morning. We drove through Houston on the way down here. That's supposed to be funny. Okay. My wife tells me, Bob, when you're only one laughing at your joke, it's not funny. Okay. God made the process so simple. We have to repent. Say, God, I did it. I sinned. Forgive me my sin, come into my life, and become a Christ follower. And the moment that decision takes place, you've given the Holy Spirit permission to begin to work on your life, and he woos you and calls you and speaks to you, and all of a sudden your word comes alive. Your prayers have more significance. You feel a peace that nothing in this world can describe. Things that seemed confusing before suddenly make sense. When you didn't know what to do, there was a voice that could direct you. All those things happen as you begin to grow in the hunger for the Holy Spirit, as you begin to say, Lord, this is good. This is really, really good. Give me more. Give me more. I tell you what, you cannot out-ask our God. You cannot out-ask our God. I've been walking with my Lord through many, many years. One thing I do every day, Father, what new thing do you want to teach me this? At first, when I did that, I said, yeah, I'm going to keep a journal of this, and then I'll be able to show people all things. God said, no, Bob, this is between you and me. I don't have a written record of it anywhere. It's recorded in heaven, I guarantee it. But the things that God has taught me, I could be in the middle of a task in the afternoon, and boom, there's my lesson for the day. God will just bring something to a phrase somebody says, or something for my wife, or you know, who knows? God just shows up. God has never, I'm 72 years old, folks, okay? I'm 72 years old. But God continues to teach me. God continues to speak into my life. I don't deserve any of it. God continues to bless. My responsibility is so simple. Get in a position he can bless. When it comes to being sanctified, and that's a key word of the Church of the Nazarene, entire sanctification, to sanctify is to set apart for a specific purpose. When I let God do that work in my life, he comes in, he cleans up my life, he sweeps out the debris of the old life. He fills with his presence, he fills with his power, and he awakens in me gifts he had already put in place that I can use uniquely to advance the kingdom of God. And that's a beautiful equation. If we put ourselves in a position that God wants to bless, the entire experience, or the experience of the entire sanctification, is about the glory of God. Kind of interesting, I had this illustration in my mind of how do I explain it, a spout. And I thought of, well, okay, you watch a football game and it's hot, and the football player is sitting on the sidelines and he takes a water bottle, takes off his helmet, just pours the water all over his head. And I thought, well, that's not a good enough illustration. But you know what happened yesterday? We're replacing a pool in our backyard, and the company we called to come and make it better made it worse. And so there was a guy there yesterday, 90 degrees outside, and he's got a cap on, and he's sweating, and it's hot, and it's just, man, it's hot. And he took his cap off, and he dipped it in the pool and picked it up, put it on his head. And I thought, well, God, that's confirmation you want me to use the illustration. Because what was he doing? Oh, man. That feels so good. And I thought, how many times have we come fatigued, exhausted, worn out, at the end of our ability, and we just dip in the fountain, and he pours it, and we just go, thank you, Father. That's the God that we serve. And if we position ourselves before him and become obedient to the Holy Spirit, the glory comes out. So this begs a very important question. How can you see the evidence of the Holy Spirit at work in your life? makes it very personal. It's just not me standing up saying, church, this is what you got to do. This brings it right down to you sitting in your seat. How can I know that I have the Holy Spirit in my life? Galatians 5:25 says, since we live by the Spirit, let us keep in step with the Spirit. You know, you got to pay attention to that. If you're walking with somebody, you got to make sure you're both at the same pace. You keep checking, yeah, we're good, we're good. Keep in step with the Spirit. Jesus promised, John 16:13, but when he, the Spirit of truth, comes, he will guide you into all truth. That's the beautiful part of this, because when I'm going to fill with the Holy Spirit, I don't have to worry about the teaching part. Jesus has got that covered, and he will bring the lessons to me at exactly the right time when I need those lessons. Really, really good at it. So there's a couple essentials. The first is this. It's essential to open my heart to the Holy Spirit if I want to live a life of joyful obedience. I have to have him. It's essential if we want God to bless and guide our church in the days ahead. This is how we live under the spout where the glory comes out, where I myself as an individual must choose on a daily basis to put myself in a place God can bless. Like, okay, Lord, where do you need me today? Now, I have a question for you. Maybe you've never thought this. How does this information help our church family know where it stands today? Think about this. If you are right now not filled with the Holy Spirit of God, and you get filled with the Holy Spirit of God, and another person gets sanctified, and another person gets sanctified, and another person gets sanctified, it's like a time clock standing. More and more and more people get sanctified. What does that do? That changes the equation of the church. That changes the balance of the church. That changes the anointing of the church. That changes the ability of the Spirit to speak to the church. It changes the volume and the frequency and the amount that the Holy Spirit of God can speak into your church. So if you as an individual decide, I'm going to get under that spout. If you as an individual say, that's what I want. I want that. I want to be in that kind of a relationship with God. And 2 do it, and 3 do it, and 5 do it, and 10 do it, and 100 do it. Oh, my goodness, what happens to this church? I've learned something about temptation. I've learned something about the devil. The Bible says, resist him, and he will flee from you. You know what? He comes back 30 seconds later. But I have learned this. Every time in the name of Jesus that I resist him, Jesus in me gets stronger, and the devil gets stronger. It may be so incrementally small you can't see it, but it's happening. Little by little by little, it's happening. God is increasing in you. The devil's power. Psalm 133, verse 1 says this. Behold how good and pleasant it is when the brothers, that's the church, live in harmony. One of the best things about being Spirit-filled is he brings you to work alongside other Spirit-filled people. And when that happens, the blessings flow. The Spirit will help us agree with his leadership to guide us forward. So I have a challenge for you as the praise team comes. And as soon as the praise team is done, we have a moment of update on the church we're going to share, and then I'll have a final word. But this is my challenge. Are you individually a part of the Spirit-filled believers who are walking in full obedience to his leadership, thus adding his voice to the church? And I want to do a very simple thing. I know it's noon. We're going to be out of here in like 5 minutes. But I want to do a very simple thing today that will help you. And by helping you, will help this. If you are simply willing to put yourself in a position that God can bless, I just want you to come and if you do it quickly because time's running out. If you just want to say, God, I'm here. I'm available to you. I don't want my way. I don't want my share. I don't want my portion. I just want you, God. I just want to be under the spout. So, God, here's the spout. The spout's here. The spout's available. The spout's open today. The disciples had to make a move. The disciples had to go to that place. I don't know if somewhere down the line, the ones that missed the room missed the blessing, but those that were there that day got that blessing, and it changed them forever. And what I'm asking you to do is just, I want to be under the spout. The Lord, here I am. I'm placing myself before you. Use me. Flow through me. Speak to me. Change me. Clean me. Make me what you need me to be. I just want to pray for you. And then we're going to sing and do the rest of the things that we got to do. Father, we lift up the name of Jesus, and we thank you and praise you for that name. I thank the Holy Spirit who is so present. He's present in this place right now. You have the very best interest of this heart, of this church at your heart. You have the very best interest of every person in this room close to your heart. Lord, you see these that have come forward today. They've gotten out of their comfortable seat, and they came and they're standing here and saying, what are they saying, Lord? They're saying, I just want to be in a position you can bless. That, what are we saying? God, I am available to you. Flow through me. Do in my life what you want me to do. I'm just laying myself down. I'm putting my burdens, my weight, my anxieties. I'm just laying them all down. It's all here on the altar, Lord. And right now, you look at every person, Father, and you just line them right up with your individual spout for their life and just open that fountain. Father, I pray that right now, waves of refreshing would just flow into every heart and every spirit, that right now, people that maybe came into this service with anxiety, it's just gone. That came here today with, oh no, what are we going to do? The fear is just gone. That the uncertainty of their individual life or the life of a church is just gone. You are the healer. You are the one who makes all this happen. So, Father, we're under the spout for your blessings out. We thank you and praise you in the name of Jesus. You may return to your seats, and we have a couple more things to share, and it's time to go home.
Seed buried in sorrow, you will call great anticipation. We await the promise to come. Everything that you have spoken will come to pass. Let it be. We await the promise to come. Everything that you have spoken will come to pass. Let it be done.
Morning. I have a 6-page speech here, so get ready. Today I want to bring you an update from Reverend Whalen and the church board. The board has been meeting monthly with Reverend Whalen on the pastoral transition process, and most recently we met this past Sunday to discuss some next steps. Over the past couple of months, we've had some wonderful speakers on Sunday mornings, many from our own congregation, and we're grateful for each one of these. But as we move forward through this interim process, Reverend Whalen discussed with the board the potential for bringing in an interim pastor so that we have stability in the pulpit until our next pastor is called. The church board considered several different options for the interim pastor arrangement and believe that God has provided direction on a path forward. This past Thursday evening, we had the opportunity to meet with Pastor Chris Easton. Pastor Chris currently serves as a chaplain in the Illinois Department of Corrections and is also leading a congregation in Sidel, Illinois. He has served our church as an interim pastor in the past. As the board talked with Pastor Chris, we were comforted by his shepherd's heart, his deep love for Christ, and the hopeful about the way he would lead the church in this season of transition. The board unanimously recommended Pastor Chris to serve in this role, and Reverend Whalen has appointed him to serve as our interim pastor beginning August 1st. Can we clap for that? Pastor Bob Anderson, who ministered to us today, will be here for the next two Sundays, and then Pastor Chris will begin in the pulpit on Sunday, August 4th. Pastor Chris will remain with us until our new pastor has been called. The board will continue to work with Reverend Whalen on the pastoral search process and will bring updates to the congregation as they are available. As a board, we want to be as transparent as possible. Always feel free to ask us any question that you like. While some items may need to remain confidential, it is our desire to keep everyone as informed on the process as we can. One other item I need to share is a staff update. This week, Reverend Whalen received a resignation letter from Sandy Chu. Sandy will be taking on the role of community director at First Nazarene in Lamont, Illinois, and will be transitioning out of her role at Grace Community. She has prayerfully sought after the heart of God and believes he has faithfully led her and Troy in this direction. She will remain on staff over the next few weeks, with her final day being Sunday, August 4th. We're thankful for Sandy, her gifts, and her service to the church. She will be deeply missed. We will be having a card shower for Sandy on August 4th. There are cards in the foyer for you to use. Please stop by and pick up some this morning. Today's update feels a little bittersweet. We know this message brings some positive anticipation with Pastor Chris coming to serve as our interim pastor, along with some sadness with Sandy's resignation. It's okay to have both feelings, sort of like life. Rarely is everything going perfectly. Even through the ups and downs, we know that God is with us. Joshua 1 reminds us, be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged, for the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go. We believe that there is no place that God is not. God is faithful, he is present, he's guiding us, and we walk in faith and hope, knowing that he who began a good work in us will carry it on to completion. As we go today, let's keep loving each other. Let's keep showing up for each other, serving each other, and do our very best to be the presence of Christ in our community. Reverend Anderson.
Remember this. God has a custom-designed spouse ready for you. Go find it. Would you stand, please? May the Lord bless you, keep you. May his face shine upon you and give you peace. Father, thank you for your day. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for your willingness to bless us, your eagerness to bless us. And Lord, in these days ahead, with information we've just received and all that is involved in that, we just give you permission to operate, pour yourself out upon this great church, these people that I already love. And I just pray, God, that as you work in them as a church, work in them individually, open the spouts and let the glory of God come out in your name. Amen. God bless you.